Namo Buddhaya. Now you can hear me, right? There's a little bit of a mistake here in the Tibetan. So when you're counting the So when you calculate the dates between the common era and the before the common era, you need to add the two dates and then subtract one from this. So when you so that is how you so that is how you calculate dates between the common era and between the common era and the before the common era. So the previous one had a typo in it. So this one doesn't. So it's better if you're going to take a picture to take a picture of this one. So if you're so the common era, the larger the number, the closer it is to us. Like 20 is close to us. If we say 1,000, it's further from us, right? So that means the greater the date in the common era, the closer it gets to me. If it's in the before the common era, then the larger the number, then it's actually further from us. So if it's 100 the common era, that's closer, than if you talk about 1,000 BC, that's further away from us. So before the common era, the larger the number, the further in the past it is. And so with the common era, the larger the number, the closer it is to us in dates. Like as I'm thinking about the difference between the years and the dates, is that there's a difference between the one. If you're thinking about 2000, when you get to the 21st century, so like there's a difference between of one between each century. When you got to the year 2000, then you add one to it, then you get to the 21st century. So for that reason, there's always a difference sort of than one between the difference between the date, the year, and the century. For example, think about 1910, it's actually 20th century. So once you got to the 1901, you've got the so that it says so like if you say 1901, then it's in terms of years, it's got a 19 to being, but you add but the century is the 20th century. So there's a difference of the century is like one number bigger. The reason for this is there's no year zero, and that is why. If there were a year zero, there wouldn't be such a difference between the dates. And also the reason why the common era dates are so important. As I said before, it's like the King Ashoka, the year of the Buddhist Parinirvana, it has to be calculated based upon the date of Ashoka's ascension to the throne. So in order to calculate the Parinirvana of the Buddha, we need to know when Ashoka ascended to the throne. But the inscriptions on the but the rock inscriptions of Ashoka do not say this was in the year 10,015. It doesn't completely doesn't say what year it is. It says after 9 years after I ascended to the throne, 1 year after I ascended to the throne. That's how it's written. And so the year that he ascended to the throne is not clearly written. So how do we know what year he ascended to the throne? So, for example, in some of the rock inscriptions, there were and some of them, the rock inscriptions record the names of kings from Greece and Egypt and so forth. And so we need to look when were those kings reigning? And we know those clearly because in those countries there was there had already been a tradition of recording dates in history. And so for that reason, those are clear. So if we can use the dates of kings from other countries to calculate when Ashoka ascended to the throne. Now, another complication is that King Ashoka, you see, even if we know the date that Ashoka ascended to the throne, it's not so easy to know how long before that it was that the the Buddha passed into parinirvana. Because there isn't any, there's, because if the King Ashoka had written an inscription saying that it was this such and such a number of years after the Buddha passed into parinirvana that I ascended to the throne, there's no such inscription. So it's like we're in this complete darkness. And so we have to basically go calculate backwards from Ashoka's ascension to the throne. It's like we're peering into the darkness. And so this is why there's some people say there's so many disagreements, some saying that it was 300 years BCE or 500 BC. Because there's so many different explanations of how many years it was prior to Ashoka ascending the throne that the Buddha achieved nirvana, that there are so many different explanations. Now, another problem that we have is that when we're calculating the dates, it's the question of the, what year it was, then the question of, well, how do they calculate the years? For example, we say that each year has 12 months and there are 30 months per day, and so we calculate then 360 days per year. But some people say that in India, that sometimes they calculated 6 months as a year. And so in that case, if you're calculating in that way, then that's a completely different way of calculating. So it's very difficult to know. So later, the thing we need to keep in mind that's very important is that the recording things in the common era dating system is very important. This is a common way of calculation that all the countries in the US, what is it? If we didn't have that, then we'd all get confused, because if every country had its own different system, we'd all get confused. So that's the reason why we need to have a common calendar system. That's a really important point. So in the future, when you're writing letters, monastery letters, or when you're writing your own individual letters, or writing your own works, it's important for you to also to use the common dating system. If you do this, then people in the future history, future historians will be able to know it, understand it. Because everyone understands the common era system, then there won't be any mistakes. Even for some amount of spends, we have so many different ways of calculating calendars. We have the Puluk, the Pur system, the Tuluk, and various different systems for calculating the calendars. And we want to, when we calculate upon each of them, then in the future, we're just going to know what they, any of them means. And so it's important that we write the dates in the common dating system accurately. Then we can also, then it's also good for us to add the Tibetan date. That's good. If we say, if we don't give the common date, but we say this is the Tsuluk, the month of the Tsuluk, so now in the future, you know, this time we know what month it is in the Tsurpa tradition, but the future people won't necessarily know. So it's important when you date things to give the common date. And then if you want to write our own calculations of the date, then you can do that. If you only write your own system, according to your own system and not according to the common system, then future people will have difficulty understanding what time it is. And then our history will get all mixed up. And so this is something that we all need to keep in mind. Likewise, when you're thinking about the common era, if we're using this name, as I said, it's very important. Some people say the external year. It's like something that came from outside, like something that's a system that came. Some people say the Western year. So it's because it's a year, it's a calendar that depends. Some say that it's the Christian era that comes with the Christian. But as I've already explained, within the whole world, if we change the name, that's the meaning of the same, but we call it the common era. If we give it that name, that's very important. This is so it's important that we continue to do this and also use the Tibetan word for common era, because in the whole world, it's been the common era. This name has been decided in the world. If we have a different name, then in the future, people in the future will not understand. Some will say they're writing Christian era. Some are paying the external era. Some people are the Western era. So what are these? What is a Christian era when the people will not understand it? And there'll be that complication too. So it's good if there's a standard. And so this is another thing that we all need to keep in mind. If we don't keep this in mind, so right now we know, but in 100, 200, or 300 years, when people are looking at history, then they're like their heads are going to get, they're going to get headaches. So we need to think about future generations and do something that's simple and easy for them. This is something we need to keep in mind. We need to think about the far into the future. We shouldn't think my tradition is important. Our tradition is important. So I'm in the Kamsang. So we had the Tsurpa tradition, the Rangdun Dorje Meizu. So that's important. So we need to write the month and the dates according to that. Of course, they're important. And I'm not saying don't put them down. But whatever date it is in the Tsurpa tradition, put it down. But in addition, that is, so you can give 500 different traditions. I'm not going to object to that. But you absolutely must put in the common era date. So now I said many pointless things. Now, if we continue with the topic. So the other day I spoke about the life of the Buddha. And so next, I would like to give a bit of an introduction to some of the more important students of the Buddha. Now, before I speak about that, though, there's something I'd forgotten to show to you the other day. I thought I should show this to you. Now, I mentioned the vase with the Buddha's relics that had been excavated from underground. I thought that it was in an Indian area. It was not in Nepal, actually. It was actually in the border regions between India and Nepal. And so actually, it was under Indian control. And so they excavated a vase from that. It was a vase of relics. And within that, when they opened the vase, they found the bones. And on the outside, it was written that these are the bones of the Buddha for the Shakyans to worship, as I mentioned the other day. And so I'd like to show you. So yeah, the other day, I forgot to show this to you. So here is where the letters are. That's where the inscription is. Now, some people say that these, there have been some people who said that they were written in modern times. But when researchers have looked at it, they say that actually that these, it's not so, that actually these really are ancient scripts. They're written in ancient times. So this is the vase. Now, where is this vase? It's in Calcutta. It's in the Calcutta Museum. If you're going to Calcutta, then there's a big museum in Calcutta, right? So if you go in there, it's in that. But I don't know if it's always on display, but it is in the museum. But the contents of it, the relics of the Buddha, are no longer there. The relics are now, most of them were given to the Thai king. Some were given to Sri Lanka, and some, as I mentioned the other day, were given to Japan. So that's how it is. And then there's the lion capital of Ashoka with the four lions, right? This is the one that is in Sarnath, right? If you go to Sarnath, you can see there's a museum in Sarnath, and you can see it there. Now, if you speak about the disciples of the Buddha, like we speak about Rahula and Ananda and Aniruddha and Nanda and Devadatta, these are all in the Kshatriya caste, right? So among them, the first three, Rahula, Ananda, Aniruddha, these three are considered among the 10 great Shravaka disciples of the Buddha. Now, there are different ways that they're counted. Now, there is in the Vimalakirti Sutra, this is the list from the Vimalakirti Sutra that I'm showing you now. Now, there is also in the Theravada, there's a sutra of the 10 elders, and that's a little bit different, which I will show you now. Now, a few of these names haven't found their names in Tibetan. So these are the names. Na Shariputra Margalyana Mahakashyapan Purna and Katyayana and Sabhuti, the Uravilva Kashyapa, Nadiush Kashyapa, and Gaya Kashyapa, the three Kashyapa brothers, were all Brahmins. So now the others, other than the three Kashyapa brothers, were also included among the 10 great Shravaka disciples. And there are also Yasha and Gavajapti. They were from the Vaishya class. And Upali and Sudita are also from the 10. And Upali, in particular, is one of the 10 great Shravaka disciples, according to the list in the Vimalakirti Sutra. So as I mentioned before, the Buddha students included members of all castes. There are Brahmas, there are Kshatriya, there were the Vaishya caste, and there are also the Shudra caste. And so in the Buddha Dharma, there's no distinction of caste or of clan. Everyone is able to practice. Not only were there various texts, there are also quite a few women Shravaka disciples. For example, the Buddha's own aunt, Mahaprajapati, his queen, Yashodhara, as Utpalavarna, was a very well-known bhikshu. They were all very well-known bhikshuni disciples. If we think among the bhikshus, among the male bhikshus, they're the greatest in praj and the greatest in miracles and so forth. And we recognize that they're those greatest disciples among the bhikshus. Likewise, among the female, among the bhikshunis, we recognize the greatest in terms of prajna and so forth, as I mentioned the other day. So I'm not going to, because of time, I don't have the time to show you all of the names in that. But if you take interest in it, they are there. Not only were all these great bhikshu and bhikshuni disciples, but there are also many lay disciples who went for refuge to the Buddha, and many of them were also superior great disciples, including Bimbisara and his son Ajatashatru, the kings of Magadha, King Prasenajit of Kosala, and basically everyone in the Shakya family, the Shakya clan, which is the Buddha's people. Likewise, also the people from the Mala peoples, in the area around Kushinagara, the Lichavis and the Kaushambis also went forth and became disciples of the Buddha. Also, like Anathapindada was one of the more well-known personages in his time, as he became a student. Also, there was a Kalpana Madandika, and then the young Jivaka, who was the great physician. Now, also, there was the elderly woman Vishaka, who was one of the great women disciples. And basically, when you speak about the students of the disciples of the Buddha, they could be found on all levels of society, high and low. From the highest levels of society down to ordinary common people, there among all of these levels, there were students of the Buddha. Now, among the students, some were siblings, some were parents, some were in the same clan, some were friends. Basically, there was no distinction of male or female or old and young. Many different students from different social backgrounds. There are many different ones. Now, if you consider the best of them or the senior of them, there are over 1,250 of these students. This is not counting the ordinary ones. These are the ones, the senior and the better disciples. If you only count those, there are over 1,250. Now, if we think about it now, that's not so much. It doesn't sound much. We think, oh, that's nothing special. In our Kaji Mulam, when we get together, we have like 3,000 or 4,000 Sangha members only. But at that time in India, there wasn't as great a population as there is these days. And so at that time, And also, you know, traveling was not so easy. So if 10,000 people could gather, it would have been an extraordinary event. And as I said before, I'm speaking about the best students, the supreme students. I'm not talking about, this is not the count of all the students that there were. So in brief, at that time, there are all sorts of different religions and different philosophies, and they're all competing with each other. They're competing to see who would be superior to the other. And at that time, only Buddhism was able to become one of the great and largest religions in the world. What was the reason for this? There are many different reasons that we can give. There are many different causes and conditions. To speak about it from one perspective, if we compare Buddhism with the Brahmanical religions of that time, Buddhism was at that time much more comprehensive. It had a much broader way of thinking. Also, not only did Buddhism have some more comprehensive, but it also was also in many ways a rebellion against many things. If we think about Buddhism was a rebellion against the customs of caste. It was a rebellion against practicing asceticism, of always practicing austerities and ascetics. A reaction against the extra different ways, saying customs and so forth, you must act in this way, you must do this or that, and spending your entire life being deceived by rituals. So these external ways. Now, of course, if it's a ritual related to the Buddhism, but if it's an external religion where you're only focused on the external aspects of it, then that's not all right. Not all right. So the Buddhism was a great reaction against that. However, the Buddha himself paid great respect to the spiritual practitioners of that time. I mentioned that there's the Brahmanical tradition, and there's also the Shramana, or the spiritual practitioner. They're both these two different traditions. So for those practitioners of the spiritual traditions, he was very respectful to them. And he was also very respectful towards the Brahmins. The Buddha was respectful towards everyone. The reason why the Buddha was so respectful, the reason the Buddha showed them respect is not because, like the Brahmins, for example, were in a high caste. So why did he respect them? It's because the Brahmins had good prajna, intelligence, and conduct. And because their prajna and conduct were so excellent, he paid respect to them. The way the Buddha would see things, what Buddha saw, there's a distinction of intelligence and conduct, but not a distinction of caste. It's not paying respect merely because they're Brahmins. It's saying that this person has intelligence, this person has good conduct, and that is why the Buddha would pay respect, as I said the other day, right? There was like the Buddha's final student, Subhadra. And he asks, like, well, what is it saying that we're all the best and I'm supreme? And so we all say that we're best and my religion is the best, but if they're all like this, then actually who is the best? And asking who is the greatest, and the answer the Buddha gave is, instead of saying, oh, this good individual is good or this individual is bad, we aren't distinguishing upon individuals. What we're distinguishing primarily on is, do they have the eight branches of the noble path? They're the prajna and the conduct. That is how we have to distinguish. We have to practice and distinguish in terms of the practice, not in terms of the individual. Now, within the Theravada Sutra, there's one called the Asalayana Sutra and the Kanakatala Sutra. If we read them, so we can see that the Buddha had such a vast and broad view. It's very clearly described in these sutras. And so for these reasons, if we read these, then we can understand it very clearly. Now, another way, if we can think about the way Upali, the noble Upali, had the most pure discipline and the most learned it in the Vinaya, and so he became very well known. Now, Upali, in terms of his caste, is a very low caste. But among the circle of the Buddha's Shravaka disciples, he was the one whom everyone paid respect to, and whom everyone knew of. And so this is, I think, good evidence of the Buddha not having any distinction of a caste or viewing everyone equally. There's also another sutra called the Sutras on the Verses of the Dhyana that is in the Theravada tradition. And within this, this speaks of it another great disciple whose name we haven't been able to find in the Tibetan tradition. We haven't found his name. Now, this is in Tibetan, it's Shunidi or Sunida in Pali. And so within the Sutra on the Virtues of the Dhyana, he was speaking about himself. There's a section where he's speaking about himself. And the meaning of this is I've translated it roughly. And so what he says is, at first, I was born in a low caste. Likewise, in my life is I'm very poor and deprived. And I always have to hurry about as someone else's servant. I'm a sweeper. Now, in the Sutra of the Wise and Foolish, it says that he was a bathroom cleaner. If you directly, it's because someone who had to clean the feces out of toilets. So he had a very bad job. And so everyone looks at me. And everyone ridicules me. Everyone looks down at me. And they always, look at me badly. I was looking at the corners of their eyes. And so the way the people look at me is like, oh, this is being inferior and bad. Otherwise, they don't look at me any other way. But no matter the way that people consider it, I'm always still have to be, subservient and respectful to everyone. I have to prostrate to everyone. But then one day, I followed some of the great disciples of the Buddha and was going, and by chance, I met the Buddha on the way. And when I met the Buddha, I took all the things I was holding in my hands and I threw them on the ground and immediately knelt down before the Buddha. And when I knelt down before him, this Buddha, with his great loving kindness and compassion, stopped walking and came to me. He came to me. And when he came to me, I immediately prostrated to his feet. And I said, please accept me as a student. I want to be your student, so please give me permission to be your student. And at that time, the Buddha, our teacher, who has no rival on this earth, turned his face towards me and says, very well, Bhikshu. Him saying, very well, Bhikshu, was the first dharma that I heard from the Buddha. He's saying, very well, Bhikshu. See, it's a Bhikshu, right? So what this shows is that the Buddha looked at the poor, deprived, and inferior people. He saw them all as like friends. He viewed them the way he would see a friend. And he saw them the way he would see a friend. So we can know that from that, because he immediately says, very well. He says, okay, you're a bhikshu. So bhikshu is a very respectful way. At that time, he hadn't become a bhikkhu, but he recognized him as a bhikshu. So among the Buddha students, among the monastics, the highest status is that of a bhikshu. So he said immediately, bhikshu. He said, sadhu bhikshu. So there's also a treatise by Master Ashvaghosha, which is called the Treatise of the Great Multitude. Now, this is not in Tibetan. And Snas mentions this name, Sunida. Now, I haven't been able to find it in Tibetan. I will look for it more. Now, he went forth, and it also describes about how Upali went forth. And this is described in detail in those, and the reason for writing this is to show the Buddha's extraordinary courage and the Buddha's extraordinary strength. So when you think about the Buddha, usually we only speak about his miracles, but actually, the strength of the Buddha, or there's a really particular, extraordinary characteristic, is that even the people, the low caste who had the most inferior, who looked down on in this society, he looked at them with respect and cared for them with great loving kindness and compassion and gave them the opportunity to practice the Dharma. And gave them all of the respect that they deserved in society. And this shows a really special quality of the Buddha and his compassion, his blessings, and his, whatever name you call it, loving compassion, it's fine. But in brief, this is what shows that. Now, another thing that we really need to take note of is that when the Buddha taught the Dharmas, he taught in the colloquial language. And this is really special. And the reason for that is, in the history up until that point, no one had done that. Now, the evidence we have for this is, like, if we look at the Vinaya Mahasaka. Now, there, and in the 25th book of the Vinaya of the Mahasasaka school, and then in the 38th book of the Sarvastivada Vinaya, this speaks a lot about this several times. Now, to give an example of this, there were two Brahmins who went forth. So they're from the Brahmin caste, and when they went forth and became monks, they had to recite sutras together as with the Sangha. And when they're reciting the sutras, now there's the pronunciation of the words and the grammar. Now, the Brahmins had studied the Vedic Sanskrit, and it's like a completely different than Sanskrit. Everyone was writing in their own colloquial dialects. They're all different, all these different languages going together. And so everyone was reciting this way, and so they got really angry. They got really unhappy, and they're like angry over this. So one day, they went and saw the Buddha and talked about this and gave their opinion to the Buddha. It said the bhikshus are all, they're from different castes. They're not the same caste. Some are Brahmins, some are Kshatriyas, some are Vaishya. They're all different castes. And they're different clans. And they also have different levels of education. Some have education, some don't. They're various different levels. So when they all recite the sutras in their own colloquial language and in their dialects, and so when they do this, then this is like an offense against the words of the Buddha. And this is now a traditional Brahmanical way of thinking, because when the Brahmanicals, Brahmins recited the Vedas, they said, if you made a mistake in pronunciation, then this is an offense to the gods. Now, this is because, as I mentioned before, that reciting the Vedas, you had to have good pronunciation. Even one mistaken pronunciation was an offense against the gods. And it's like in Sanskrit, there's such great attention on the pronunciation and reciting properly. And with good pronunciation, it was really important to them. And when they get to the Buddhas, the bhikshus just say anything. They're all giving their own dialects and language and reciting that way. And like they got headaches and thought, this isn't just going to work. We can't stay here. And so now in the future, they said, so it's best to say that in the future to everyone to recite them in Sanskrit. It's best if everyone will recite the sutras in sutras. Instead of everyone just reciting them like goats and sheep, it's no good. And so, this is going to just kind of reduce the majesty of the Buddha's teachings. It's going to be an offense, they said. So the answer that the Buddha gave is that It says it's not necessary to recite sutras in other languages or scripts that come from other. No, it's okay to write them in whatever your own dialect is or own colloquial language is. So if in the future, if you don't use your own native language and use another foreign language, then that's an offense, he said. Now, what they were asking for and what the Buddha said were just completely opposite to each other. Because they were saying we should bring in Sanskrit as new and recite that. And the Buddha said, no, we don't need to use new languages in the future. Recite in whatever language you know, recite them in that language. You don't need to learn a language. And if you do learn and have to learn a new language to recite them, then that's an offense. So it's not need a lot to talk about this in detail or read it so much. But the main point is that the intent of the Buddha is that the Dharma is taught in order to benefit sentient beings. So the blessings of the Dharma, needs to strike all sentient beings, to contact all teachers, and not just some and not others. And so therefore, all the Buddha's teachings absolutely have to be simple and easy and to understand. And if that happens, then there'll be something that people will be able to understand and able to study. If it's, you know, write them only in Sanskrit, then only people who have education, people who have studied, will be able to understand them. I had some Indian teachers speak there. I asked him, how long does it take to study Sanskrit? He said, it's 10 or 20 years. So before you study, if you want to know, you have to spend 10 or 20 years. Or you need to learn it from the time you're little, or you need to work hard for 10 or 20 years. And then during that time, you would have no chance to practice the Dharma during that time. And so for that reason, when he taught the Dharma, he first taught the Dharma in colloquial. And his students in around him also recited the text in colloquial. And so this is beginning a new tradition. And the reason why he started that is so to be able to give to allow more sentient beings to understand and realize the meaning of the Dharma. That's why he established this way of doing things. So at that time, the thing we need to understand is that, how do I say this? If we speak about this in terms of Mahayana, ways. The Buddha coming to awakening is like a common presentation. Everyone accepts it to be achieved awakening. But the teaching of the Dharma, when I think about that, really shows a lot of the Mahayana features. The reason why it shows so many features of the Mahayana is that after the Buddha achieved awakening, he had achieved the benefit for himself. And because he had done that, if he hadn't taught the Dharma and just stayed, it would be okay. Because who would understand the Dharma? There was no one to teach the Dharma. No one was coming and asking him to the Dharma. We say Brahma and Indra came to ask him. Now, if Brahma and Indra came, that's a different matter. But if we aren't speaking about Brahma and Indra, after the Buddha achieved enlightenment, when he was sitting there was no one around him. So even if the Buddha hadn't taught the Dharma, then no one would say, oh, the Buddha's not teaching the Dharma. No one would have raised it, and there was no one around him. And so no one came to ask him to teach the Dharma. And so the Buddha had no responsibility or job that he had to practice the Dharma. If he was a teacher, then the people would say, oh, the teacher's not going to the classes. He's not teaching the students. Because he has the title of a teacher. Someone has a title of teacher and the responsibility of teacher, right? But at that time, no one was giving, saying, you're the teacher, and giving him the responsibility of teaching. And so if he had just continued to sit in that peaceful expanse, then there wouldn't have been anyone who would have raised any problems. So there's no difference to the Buddha whether he taught the different or not. But who is there a difference for? It's for other sentient beings. And so he thought quite a lot. And in the end, whether there was someone else asking him to teach the Dharma, he decided to teach the Dharma. And the person who decided was that, the fact that he decided that shows that he had the courage of the Mahayana. It's a sign of the Mahayana there. So among all the different sutras of the Buddha, this is for looking for like a symbol or like an example of the Mahayana Dharma. It is teaching the Dharma, teaching sentient beings the Dharma is like a sign of the greatest qualities of the Mahayana. Actually, before I say, I'm going to speak about this. Now, after the Buddha passed away, there was like the Buddhist organization, shall we say, after what happened after the Buddha passed away. There were many students that I mentioned, right? So after the Buddha passed away, then there's like how did the organization or Sangha develop? To speak about that in brief, basically after the Buddha passed into Parinirvana, the main region where the Buddha's disciples stayed was like Magadha. Basically, it wasn't so much in other regions. For example, if you think about the place where he passed away in Kushinagar or the place he was born in Lumbini, both of these are considered the northern part of the central India, right? The place where the Buddha, the place where he achieved liberation in Bodh Gaya is in the south part. The place where he turned the wheel of Dharma in the Deer Park was in the west. And so after that, we had the four great sites of Buddhism. So there are the four Buddhist sacred sites. Now these four great sacred sites are well known now, right? So these are the four sites, right? The place of the birth, the place of enlightenment, the place of turning the wheel of Dharma, and the place of his passing into pure Nirvana. These are the four great sites. Now, all of these four sites are in the central region. So if we think about the followers of Buddhism in terms of geographical regions, or talk about in terms of the Dharma, it is central India, which means the central parts of India, which is the area of Magadha, which, so that is why we recognize Magadha as like the central area of India. Now, you, of course, all know the four sacred sites. There's Bodh Gaya, where he achieved enlightenment. There's Deer Park in Sarnath, where he first turned the wheel of Dharma. Now, people will speak about these. The place where he was born was Lumbini, and the place where he passed away is Kushinagar. Now, three of these sites are in India. One of these, Lumbini, is in Nepal. Later, we also spoke about the eight great sites. We don't need to go through each of them. You can look and see. First, there are central regions, and then gradually the Sangha spread, went to the west and the south and the west. They began to spread the teachings to the south of the central regions. There's like the mountains, the Vindhya Mountains. And these are kind of like a natural boundary. This kind of made like a, and then to the east is very hot. And also the people, also place that people at that time did not really use very much. And in particular in the southwest, the Buddha spread further and further every day. So from the beginning, the Dharma spread first primarily in the West, and then gradually it spread into the South. So first spread in the West. However, if like within our 10 great Shravaka disciples, there's the noble Kacayana. He went to the region of Avanti. It was his homeland. So he later returned to his homeland and taught the Dharma to many people. This is all clearly described in the Vinaya scriptures. Also, there is Purana, the son of Metya, was from a place called Suparananta. And then this is probably in the western regions of India, probably on the sea coast. And so I think it's in the south a little bit. So later, they found an Ashokan pillar in this region. In terms of these days, it's probably nearer to Mumbai. And so it's in the region of Mumbai. So he also returned to his homeland and taught the Dharma and gained many students. And so the Buddha's students traveled all over, and then gradually the Dharma began to spread to various different regions of India. And so this is the beginning of the Dharma's Dharma beginning to spread. Like there are also many merchants who had great faith in the Buddha's teachings. And among these many sutras, merchants from various different regions would come to central regions. They'd go for refuge to the Buddha, and then they'd return to their homelands and spread the teachings. And so those merchants, of course, have to travel to many different regions. And so for that reason, this was very influential in spreading the Dharma in many different regions. So also, Katayana also went to Mathura. So as in the past, it was called Mathura. Now these days, it's in the vicinity of Delhi. And so he also spread the Dharma in this region. So if you think about the mother, the basis of spreading the Dharma is the Sangha. It's like the community of the Sangha, right? The responsibility of spreading the Dharma is the monastic's responsibility. The reason is because the Sangha use all of their time to engage in listening, contemplating, and meditating on the Dharma. And so their work, their job is to spread the Dharma. So when you think about what their job is, what their particular work they do is that. Of course, the lay practitioners also practice Dharma, but they also have many household activities that they have to do and don't have as much time as a monastics do. So they're not as able to spend as much time listening, contemplating, and meditating on the Dharma or studying the Dharma as monastics do. So the mother or the basis of spreading the Dharma is the Sangha. So when we're talking about the community of monastics, we call it this the Sangha. What this means is that they're harmonious. It means like a harmonious Sangha, a harmonious community is what it means. So the Buddha's followers would consider the Buddha as like the Sutra, the teacher who taught the Dharma. Yes, they viewed him as someone who was teaching them the path. And they had great, one-pointed faith from him. And then because of that, then the reason why the followers of the Buddha were called the listeners of the Shravakas is because the Buddha would teach the Dharma, and the ones who listened to it were his followers. And so these his students who were followers were called the listeners. For that reason, that's why they're called the listeners. Now, when you say about in the Mahayana, we talk about the listeners, we think about that them as being the foundation figures, being inferior. But actually, it's those who heard the Buddha, listened to the Buddha teaching the Dharma are called the listeners. So it means those who are listening to the Dharma when we say listeners or Shravakas. Now, there's a Theravada Sutra, where the Sangha is compared to an ocean. This is a Theravada Sutra, and I'd like to introduce it to all of you. I think it's kind of a new way of some new description. We don't have much discussion of this within our Tibetan tradition. So the Sangha is compared to an ocean said to have eight wondrous qualities, and what they are is like the Buddha gets the ocean gets deeper and deeper, right? The further you get close to the center, the ocean gets deeper and deeper, right? Similarly, the Sangha also gradually trains in the path, and their qualities of realization grow larger, greater, and greater. Secondly, the ocean's waves, no matter how large they are, do not cross the shores. Now, tsunami, of course, is different. Of course, it goes across the land, but similarly, the Shravakas do not violate discipline. They never go beyond the boundaries of their discipline. Now, the third wondrous quality is that just as like a corpse, whether a human corpse or an animal corpse, they don't stay in the ocean. The ocean washes them up on the ocean, casts them up on the shores. Likewise, among the Sangha, those who violate the discipline, they have offenses. Now, the fourth is like the all 100 rivers can all flow into the ocean. And no matter how many different types of water, they all flow into the ocean, disappear into the ocean. Likewise, the Sangha masters come from different castes and different clans. But when they all go forth, and in the end, they're all called the children of the Sanghas. They're called the children of the spiritual practitioner, the Buddha, the Shakyamuni. And so this is in the fourth wondrous quality. Now, the fifth wondrous quality is that just as the entire ocean has a salty water, it tastes salty, right? When you drink it, it has a salty taste, right? So the entire ocean has the same taste. Likewise, the entire Sangha has the same flavor, the same flavor of liberation. Now, the sixth wondrous quality is hundreds of rivers flow into the ocean, and they flow into it, but no matter how many rivers flow into it, the ocean never increases, gets larger, nor does it ever decrease. Likewise, within the Sangha, there are, of course, many individuals who achieve liberation or achieve arhatship, but the Sangha itself never decreases or increases in number. Also, in the great ocean, there are many different jewels, like there's coral and pearls and so forth. Likewise, the Sangha also has many wondrous qualities, many with great intelligence and great discipline and so forth. Now, the last of these is that there are many fish in the ocean, and among them, there are many large fish. Similarly, within the Sangha, there are many superior individuals. So these are the wondrous qualities, and I think these are really nice. So I think the basic organization of the Buddha is the Sangha. Now, those who wish to enter the Sangha, whoever they were allowed to enter. It wasn't a question of some people of only a few castes were able to enter. Anyone could enter, whether of whatever caste, whatever social class, high or low, they could enter. Like in some religions, only people in their ethnic group are allowed to enter, right? But it's not like that. There's no distinction of caste or nationality. Anyone could enter the Sangha. Now, the life of a monastic at the beginning was like a wandering lifestyle, as I mentioned the other day. I think that when speaking about the history of the Hindus or the non-Buddhists, like we said, we spoke about the fourth phase of when they travel and live in a wandering lifestyle. So it's the same point. So they had no fixed place where they stayed and had to travel from location to location. And so for that reason, the requisites that they lived in usually had to be very few. They're very few. There was nothing complicated because they had to go anywhere at all times. So it wasn't easy for them to carry a lot of heavy or difficult things. And so for that reason, had very simple requisites, because in terms of their clothing, they only had the three Dharma robes. And the other they had were the alms bowl that they'd eaten. They had the mat that they spread on the ground, and they had a water filter. So those were called the six requisites. A very easy, simple lifestyle. These are the things that they only had six things they used on a daily basis. Now, the main material from the originally was wool. Primarily made from cotton at first, but later it was made from like linen or silk and wool and so forth. But when you're making the three robes, you have to need a lot of material because the robes are big. And so it's difficult to get them from alms. And so for that reason, the robes, the bhikshu, the Sangha members always had to use the same robe all the time. They didn't have extra robes to change into. Likewise, from the bhikshu has always had to go to different places. So if you're going someplace tomorrow, you wouldn't know whether it's going to be a place for them to stay. There's no certainty that it's going to be a nice place to stay. So, you know, all the time, frequently the bhikshus of that time had to stay at in unpopulated wilds or stay at the base of a tree. Now, there were many times when this had to happen. But the best thing about India, other than the rainy season in the morning, in the summer, there was no rain in India. And so it wasn't all that difficult to stay under trees. And particularly within the Sangha, there were some who practiced special austerities. And so those people really wanted to practice austerities. All their practices were compiled in what we call the 12 or the 12 qualities of austerity. Some say there are 12, sometimes there are 13, but there are these qualities of austerity. There are some who were some of the Sangha who were known as being more interested in practicing these qualities of austerity. For example, Mahakashyapa became famous for remaining within these qualities of austerity. So, as I mentioned before, I spoke about how the Buddhist students appeared and their organizations. Now, after the Buddha passed into Nirvana, when the original scriptures were compiled, how did the scriptures come about? Like we have the Khandur in Tibetan, how did the words of the Buddha? The Khandur, of course, is the words that are translated into Tibetan. So we're talking about the words of the Buddha, and particularly the original scriptures of the Buddha, the original words of the Buddha. Now, there are many different positions about this, and I don't need to speak about them all. Basically, after the Buddha passed away, the elder Mahakashyapa realized that if they just left the teachings of the Buddha as they were, didn't take care of them, they would quickly disappear. And so he had the idea of having a council. And so he gathered all of the elders, he gathered all the bhikshus, and he shared his opinion with all of them. When he agreed, when he shared it with them, then everyone said, "Your opinion is good," and everyone agreed. And once they had all agreed, then in Rajgira, 500 students of the Buddha, 500 senior disciples of the Buddha gathered in Rajgira, and they all compiled the words, the teachings of the Buddha. This is called the First Council. Now, when you talk about the word council, there's also another understanding of this word. It can also mean reciting together. So perhaps what happened is that the students at that time, so maybe they all recited all the texts that they had memorized. There was no writing at that time, or they hadn't written them down at that time. They had kept them all in their memory. And so each person, if 500, then that all have image in their own memory, and so they'd all get together. And so I've got this amount of sutras that I've memorized, and they'd all recite them, and they'd all recite the words that they remembered. Now they hadn't written any of down, but they repeated them all and gathered them. Otherwise, you wouldn't know how many this one remembers, how many that one remembers. But when they all get together and recite them together, then it becomes like a body, right? And so that is how the council happened. Now, many later recitals often say that there actually wasn't a first council, they said. They say this, but if we look at the text of the 18 different schools, there is a lot written about the topic of the first council. And so I think that it is probably the case that the first council did happen. There may be different details in it. There's a different the first council or a time when they all gathered to compile the teachings of the Buddha, and they had this meeting, and this meeting must have happened. Now at that time, when we're having the council, there are 500 disciples gathered. There are two primary ones. These two are, one was Ananda. So Ananda, he was given the responsibility. His responsibility was teaching the Dharma, or the Dharma that the Buddha had taught. So Ananda was primarily used to teach through the Buddha's Dharma. Because Ananda was always with the Buddha, and so he heard all the Dharma, and he remembered it all. And so basically everything that the Buddha had said, he had heard. And so for that reason, Ananda recited the Dharma. And then the Vinaya was recited by who? It was recited by the noble Upali, who was the most learned in the Vinaya. So they were the two most important personages in that instant. Now, the way we're explaining it, I'm describing this primarily according to the Theravada tradition. Now, there's a different way that it's explained within our Tibetan tradition. Now, the texts that they recited were then became the basis of the two baskets of the sutras and the Vinaya. Well, so what about the basket of the Abhidharma? We spoke about the other two. There are three. So how did the Abhidharma happen? Well, this appeared a bit later. There are like commentaries on the sutras. And also then in order to memorize the sutras and Vinayas, remember their important points, they're recorded in the sutras in very easy way. They're also arranged in verses, and those are called the gathas. Now, later they add a few commentaries to the sutras, and they added some background stories to the gathas. They're all compiled in those compilations were called the gateways to the Dharma. Later, sutras also appeared in prose form. But the first, when you talk about sutras, we're primarily talking about in verses, in short verses that people could easily memorize. That's probably what it was originally. And many of these sutras, you know, they say that the sutras in prose probably happened a little bit, about 100 years after the Buddha. They added a little bit of commentary. They explained, they added the background stories for it, so forth. And therefore, they became a little bit longer. And so this is around 100 years after the Buddha passed away, as according to the hypothesis of many researchers. That must be enough for today. That's enough for today. We'll leave it here. And I'll speak about the rest tomorrow. That's already quite a bit. So that's enough for today. So next, I'd like to make a little bit of an announcement. The first is that tomorrow is the last day of the teachings. So we've been adding more days and more days to the teachings. And so if I continue doing that, and so I've been teaching her just about a month. And if I add more, then it's a little bit different. I've gotten a little bit tired. And not only that, if I'm saying that I'm getting tired, if I'm saying that, it's also, if I say that it's good, it's not good. But for you to know it's good. Basically, from morning to evening, I haven't spent even a minute resting. So I've worked really hard. So if I continue working really hard, then it's not going to be good for my health. And so we will leave it there for this year. And so tomorrow will be the last day of our teachings. Now, originally, we had plans to recite some texts, but if we don't have time to recite a whole lot. So I've compiled a short ritual about the life of the Buddha. So I've spoken about rituals, and I'm saying there's no point to rituals and stuff. I've said this so much, but now I've compiled a sutra, a ritual. Now, this ritual, there's a Kadampa ritual about for the Buddha Shakyamuni. And this is in the Treasury of Precious Instructions. And it is also in the Ocean of Jewels compiled by the Jonang master Taranata. So I'm taking those as a basis and have compiled a short ritual for the Buddha Shakyamuni. We'll recite that tomorrow. Since these days I've been speaking about the life of the Buddha, so yesterday I'm just suddenly put it all together. And so tomorrow we'll have like some sort of a feast, shall we say. So if you get a little bit of a feast. You don't need anything that's in plastic and packages. Like, it's best to use fruit. If you can't find any fruit, then what you should do is you should go and look and see what you have and do and get as much as you can together. So tomorrow we're going to have a bit of a feast. So we combine that with this ritual tomorrow, and we'll have the tsaru, the feast of tsaru. So I thought I should mention that to all of you. We will do that at the end of the teachings tomorrow. Now, the next point is, we have this the spring teaching, the Chenpo teaching, so there's some spring teaching. Now we have here the summer teachings. And we have the Gunsha, the winter teachings. Now the autumn teaching, I don't know. If we have too much to teach, there's a won't work out. So there's not really much of an autumn in India or Nepal, so we won't worry about that. So basically we have the winter. So think about whether you should have an autumn teacher in the future, but we do have the winter teaching. We have the Kaju Gunsha. During the Kaju winter teachings, we'll have. Last year, I taught on the four dharmas of Gampopa. So what should I teach about this year? I do have an idea, but before, I don't need to mention my idea first. And I'd like to ask the Shudra Kempos to have a discussion to see what would be best to speak about, what topic would be best, what is going to be the most beneficial for you. So if you could please discuss this and then share that with me. And then after you've all compiled your ideas, then I will mention my ideas. So now we have the closing prayers. Oh, yeah.
Recording stopped.
You're the son of the Lord.